Okay, question number two.
More Brexit, I'm afraid. Bearing in mind that Tripping Barnet electorate voted strongly in favour of Remain in last year's referendum, what do you, as a potential representative of these voters, hope and fear from the results of the Brexit negotiations? And what kind of negotiating stance do you think will bring about the best deal for Britain, faced with the need to reach an agreement with 27 other countries, all presumably anxious to safeguard the EU?
What I personally fear is the how transparent the negotiations are going to be, and therefore I think it would be a very good thing if we do have more opposition, and that includes a party with a stronger presence to the left of the Labour Party to keep them in order, if you want, but to make sure we've got a strong opposition there that's doing a really proper scrutiny. I make sure we do know about what's going on. What we could have there are possibilities of hopes of a more ecological agricultural policy. We could have a better air pollution policy, which is what the Green Party, we want to have a new air pollution law, which may be stricter than the EU air pollution law. And also environmental protection, we want to make sure that's going to be the case. So this depends. Okay, I may have my doubts about which, you know, who's going to be pulling the strings here, to be quite honest, but this is what I hope. That was the question, what are your hopes and your fears? We want better scrutiny. To sum up, we want better scrutiny. We want to look at the aspects that weren't discussed in the referendum, make sure they are properly discussed, and we can use social media here, and to try and get around our press. And we just have to do the best we can and hope that we do end up with a referendum at the end of it all.
Are you watching? Yes, interesting.
As I said in my opening remarks, I think our aspiration, our goal for the Brexit negotiations should be a new settlement with our European neighbours, with which the majority in this country can be comfortable, whichever side they were on in the referendum. So I think we should seek an extensive free trade agreement with our European neighbours. I think we should seek to continue a range of ways in which we cooperate on security matters. I believe it must be a high priority to secure the rights of EU nationals in this country and UK nationals living in the rest of Europe. And I think it is also vital that we do all we can to ensure that we have a border between Northern Ireland and the Republic of Ireland, which is as open and free-flowing as possible. I believe our future lies outside the single market and outside the customs union, because remaining in those structures isn't genuinely leaving the European Union. If we're going to respect the results of the referendum, then a free trade deal is what we should be looking for. Staying in the single market would leave us accepting almost all of the laws of Europe, and also it would leave us accepting unqualified free movement, unamended. And I don't think either of those is consistent with the vote which took place last year. We'll start with the hopes. The hope is that you have two good options and that you have a vote, which is a close one, of two good choices to vote upon, and that you get that choice. And the fear is this, that we're at capacity, we don't have the capacity to negotiate with the 27 as well as we should do, that we don't have the skills. Now, admittedly, in my party, we do have the skills. At another venue in Barnet is a skilled EU negotiator, and I've
worked on the commercial front. You're inside a free movement of goods and services body at the moment. Why on earth would you want to get out of it so that you have to count everything as it goes in and out and pay a little bit of an extra charge for it to go in and out of the European Union? It will disrupt supply chains immensely. It will disrupt the manufacturing of all kinds of goods, of cars and many, many other goods, all technology. I ask you to consider whether you want to have everything stopping at the border to be counted in relatively unproductive ways, whether you want to add a whole lot more bureaucracy. You're actually introducing a lot of bureaucracy. I know what I'm talking about. I worked on supply chain for a major retailer. And before that, I worked on a European project for a FMCG, a fast-moving consumer goods manufacturer. I know about this in detail. It is perhaps hard for a specialist to explain how much extra work and how much money you will pay for this, for no good reason. It is quite possibly, I am quite possibly the only person in the room who understands this. Outside this hustings, I was told by someone that it hasn't quite hit how expensive this is. Meanwhile, we talk about a penny on income tax. We talk about a penny here and a penny there. But you are voting, if you vote to leave the customs union, for massive cuts because our country has to stay solvent. Beware of what you are voting for. Understand it fully. Take the 18 months and demand a vote at the end of it yourself. Not a consultation with people who might not have understood. You need the final say. It is your responsibility for your life.
So I'm going to start by answering my stance on negotiation. Well, my number one would be giving an immediate guarantee to all EU nationals that they have the right to stay. A guarantee that should be given. Government last year. But one of the things I learned at law school was negotiation, and I also learned how to go to court, and they are two very different skills. One is adversarial and one is about compromise. So my stance on negotiation will always be about reaching out, about trying to find the common ground, because there is common ground with Europe. I don't believe the rhetoric that they just want to punish us. To punish us is to punish themselves. There is a middle ground, and we can find it if we work cooperatively with Europe to find that space. So my hopes, as I say, and EU nationals, staying within Horizon 2020, getting involved, keeping Erasmus, retaining access to Eurotrop, keeping access to the security measures that keep our countries safe. My fears are that we will pull out of the single market and we will end up with a weaker economy as a result. My fear with family in the north of Ireland is that we will have a hard border and we will go back to the My fears are all of the things that I think worry every one of us when we look at the newspapers about the future of Britain, is that this is going to make us a smaller, inward-looking country and not the diverse nation that we are, the open nation that we are, and the accepting nation that we are. And that's the future I want for my nephews and their friends. I want them to have all of the opportunities that I have had as an EU resident, even if we are out. We will take back power, and I hope that when that power is moved back, it isn't moved straight back into the hands of the 650 MPs in Westminster. I would hope that with the return of power, this is what's been talked about by Theresa tonight, that it's about returning that power to us, that it is given back to people in regions, that we look at a new devolution deal, so that if we are taking back that power, it is given to the people and not held by people in Parliament and kept away from you, so that you can have a say in how this country moves forward after Brexit.
This third question up here, question number three.
My question again is about the Brexit negotiations. Sorry. It is important. Does your party guarantee EU citizens continuing residence in the UK?
I believe that should be our top priority in the negotiations, as I've said. I believe also, though, we need to make sure that we secure the rights of UK nationals living in the rest of the EU. There's 1 million of them, there's 3 million EU citizens. We need to protect their rights across the board. We can only do that bilaterally through the negotiations, but I'm absolutely confident that that is going to be delivered. And it's vital that it is, because the contribution that EU nationals make to this country is incredibly valued. It is vital in relation to our public services and our economics, that all those EU nationals who are living here absolutely should be given the right to stay, and we need to secure that through the negotiations to come.
Why negotiations? We'll give them now.
The answer is yes.
I think I've made myself clear on it that the answer is yes, but what I would say is Theresa has said it's her top priority. She's voted against it 11 times.
Well, I have German ancestry. I've got a son in Germany I want to keep in contact with, and German friends. I tried, at the back of my mind, rather quite a few doubts, because we have seen some new terms recently in the government we've got. I tried to get a German passport a few months ago. I'm still waiting. Reason being, because a lot of people who are descendants of the Kinder transports who you know about, who were taken over here, Jewish people, who have now decided to get up German passports. And so there's a long waiting list to get a German passport, which is interesting because it's not just me who's got these nagging worries at the back of my mind, but also a lot of other people as well.
Yes.
I'd have been dealt with by now in the German embassy.
Moving on from Brexit, I'm sure you're glad to hear. question on health, number four. Jenny, where are you?
I'm Jenny Brimfrey. In view of the problem of recruiting enough doctors and nurses at the high cost of tuition fees, wouldn't it be a good idea to make their training free on condition that they work with the NHS for 2 years after qualifying, so that they don't immediately go overseas in search of higher paid jobs?
Yep, that's a good idea.
So the Liberal Democrats, our policy is to reinstate bursaries for nurses, which were recently removed, and that will certainly help with their tuition. It's an interesting idea. It hasn't been raised with me before, and please would you get in touch to discuss it with me again, so that I can consider it further. But certainly we are thinking along those lines already, because we have got a specific policy to reintroduce the bursaries, which we see as very important. I have personal experience of difficulty in recruiting doctors and nurses, having been myself a member of the board of a hospital, and therefore I would very much appreciate it if you came and found me later after this session. Thank you very much for the question.
The Labour Party is also committed to reintroducing bursaries, and we also want to look at funding for health-related degrees. But the other thing that we have obviously done in our manifesto manifesto is we would scrap tuition fees for all. Yeah. So we would be scrapping university fees so that all our young people could go to university, train and come away debt-free. We would also look at scrapping the pay cap so that even when they are qualified, they stay here and put the decisions about pay into the hands of independent pay review bodies so that the future is not about government taking control of our NHS pay and strangling our healthcare workers. That this is an independent body that cannot be overruled by party politics.
I also fully agree with Bursis and being able to allow us to train free. We're also against tuition fees as well. And if you want to not put your eggs in one basket, you can always come and discuss this with people in the Green Party. If you have more chance to push this idea forward.
Jenny, I'm afraid I can't give you the promise that you want because I don't think it's affordable. There are many things that we would like in this life to be free.
Yeah, they can afford to try them, though.
They have to be paid for. And we've heard this evening there are many spending commitments being made left, right and centre by both Labour and the Lib Dems. But the reality is we have to live within our means as a country. We saw what happened when the last Labour government overspent massively. That leads to a severe financial crisis. You only have to look around.
That was the banks.
You only have to look around the rest of Europe to see what happens when the government loses control. End up having to cut funding for public services. We believe that the secret, the way that we fund our higher education system, the way we fund our public services is by maintaining a strong economy. And you require sound public finances and to live within your means as a country in order to do that. And putting a coalition of chaos led by
Okay, missed that part. Sorry.
Thank you. Question number 5. Derek, you're here. Would like to stand on the microphone for 5 minutes.
I have very strong views on Brexit, and I'm going to spare you. It's an entirely different subject. 80% of the population wish to see the law changed to allow a person expected to have less than 6 months to live to be able to help to achieve a dignified death at the time of their choosing. Some people express concern that such a person might choose to die sooner, partly as a result of feeling that their slow death would be an emotional, physical, or financial burden upon their loved ones. I see that as a perfectly reasonable and rational reaction. I would like to ask each candidate, is it likely, or at least distinctly possible, that you would support a change in the law when the matter next comes before Parliament?
I wouldn't want to commit to saying whether I would vote for any bill without seeing it, but I would want to see, one, the medical evidence of how this would happen. It may sound a very harsh thing to say, but it should be a choice. But if it's going to be an individual's choice, there must be, for me, medical evidence that backs up how this would happen, but also that we must put in place a legal framework where the decision is entirely the individual's, where there can be no undue influence from family for financial reasons or emotional reasons. And I would want guarantees, both as a daughter, about my parents if they ever wanted to take this decision, but also as a lawyer, that they were making this decision free on their own without any interference from anyone else. And if that could be guaranteed to me in the law, and I think that's a very hard test to put on the law, I would have to consider very carefully, and I would want to talk to my constituents as well, how I would vote on that.
But once a law like that was in place, I think a law that is constructed should be about creating a space in which an individual has the privacy to make that decision. And once that decision is taken by society, that that is an area we are allowing, like an abortion, we must then let the state step back and leave it to the individual. Thank you.
Well, Derek, we've discussed this issue at length. I'm afraid my views on this haven't changed. I couldn't vote for that kind of change in the law. I feel that no matter how strong the safeguards, no matter how tough the regulatory regime, there would still be a risk that vulnerable elderly people felt somehow a sense of obligation to take the option of assisted dying. And so I just couldn't countenance a change of the law to allow or to legalise assisted dying. I just think there is too much of a danger that people would end up going down this path when they didn't really want to, but they just felt that it was the right thing that they ought to do for their relatives. So the ethical issues are impossible to grapple with in a 30-second answer, but no, I'm afraid if it comes before Parliament again, I would vote against legislation to legalise assisted dying.
This is an issue on which I've changed my mind and on which I might do so again in conversation with yourselves. So let me give you some background. My first voluntary work when I was 17 at school was in what we would now call social care, helping an occupational therapist who worked with stroke victims. And one February, four of them died, some of whom I was very fond of, having worked with them every Wednesday afternoon from the beginning of the school year. And therefore, I have real people in mind when you talk to me about this. Later on, my father was told that he would have a slow, he was given 6 months to live, and a very difficult 6 months too. And then he died in a matter of weeks later, actually at this time of year, so I always think of it at this time of year. And I remember how glad I felt that he did not have to have that slow, painful death, and that no one had had to make a decision about it, that it had happened on its own. I live with an elderly relative of my own, who thinks strongly that we should all have the right to a dignified death. And this person is also, like Emma, a lawyer. And yet, I have my doubts. And the reason why I have my doubts is because they introduced this into the Netherlands. And then people came and spoke to the committees of the Houses of Parliament who had changed their minds. And those people who had changed their minds made me consider whether I was right in saying that there should be a right to a dignified death. And therefore, I will genuinely listen to you, and I have genuinely been in the situation, and I have someone in my own family with whom I live who lobbies me that I should be signing the right to a dignified death. But I, learning from the experience of the Netherlands, I would want the matter reviewed. So whatever decision is taken, I would want it reviewed, because this is an area that's moving forward constantly and that I'm tracking.
This is something that is partly outside my experience, but I would think that I would not want to have a slow, painful death. I would not wish that on anybody else. And I do agree with one thing that Emma said, that you need to have, there are all sorts of caveats that could crop up, like are the relatives being manipulative about what that person might be wishing or not, or being put under undue pressure, and how we can check that that is not happening, and how we actually go about it, I'm not too sure. That we need this is something I'm sort of very two-minded about. And another thing is actually bordering on suicide with the dementia tax. If people think they've got dementia and they are worried about not being able to inherit a house to their loved ones or their descendants, they are loved ones, of course, is that it could be we might be okay. It could be that we might be seeing a much higher suicide rate in future because people might actually consider they want to leave their house to their loved ones. That is really another topic, but it's sort of bordering on that, this question.
Question number six, if you stand.
This is the question about foreign policy and specifically support for the United Nations. Now that we have a very well-respected and experienced UN Secretary General, Antonio Guterres, will you support increasing UK funding for UN peacekeeping and human rights activities? Will you personally support the commitment to spend at least 0.7% of gross national income on international aid? And what is your position regarding the UK's international obligations to refugees? Thank you.
On the first question, I think it would depend on the project that the UN was undertaking, but obviously it's important that we meet all our obligations to fund the UN funds. On the 0.7% of GDP spending on international development, that is something which is in the Conservative manifesto, so I would vote to retain that. It's obviously already on the statute book, though we are committed to reforming it to ensure it works better. And in terms of refugees, it is of course vital that we comply with all our international obligations, and I think in particular in relation to the Syria conflict, we must continue the work we're doing to support displaced people in the region and also to deliver on our commitment to provide a haven for 20,000 refugees from the region fleeing from the Syria conflict. All of these are vitally important. We should remain a safe haven for those fleeing persecution.
One of my best friends from university was from Syria. She moved to Amman in Jordan. For me, Syrians are people like my best friend, because my best friend was Syrian. Just keep that in mind. They're not people to be demonized. They're like people from India, like people like my family. They're like people from the UK. Refugees should never, ever be demonized. They are human beings. And when I spoke initially of being humane, the answer was yes, we will do, we will make our economy thrive, we will give 0.7%, and we will thrive so that we can share. And what is more, when we engage in areas of conflict in future, we must consider our part in not creating additional refugees. We must beware, we must be more intelligent in our engagement in conflict. We have all the knowledge, actually here in the community in Barnet, because individuals have been getting in touch with me from the community. The political parties are not harnessing the knowledge of how to manage conflict, how to minimise the creation of refugees. We can do better than 0.7%. We can do more to address climate change. We can address conflict more intelligently. We will make, as Liberal Democrats, your 0.7% go much further. And we won't just talk about making your money go further in the UK. We will make your money go further outside the UK because of intelligent foreign policy. Thank you very much for the question.
Well, the question is funding for, I want to say catastrophic because I've been journey for so long. The world, having protecting against catastrophes in the world. Now, one problem we've got with our army is it's very badly funded, and there should be more money to actually improve and make it more flexible. a conventional force, and one problem we've got is trials, which is, I think, in 2009, when there were quite a few generals, General Ransbottom, for example, who were very critical of Trident. I don't want to mumble too much. Very critical of Trident. And they pointed out that this is a real waste of money. It just does one thing, and you really need a more flexible conventional army to do things like environmental protection. We've got more and more catastrophes around the world because of climate change. We've got more refugees because of climate change. Militias framed from Syria. In Syria, there has been a drought for about the last 7 years, which has also been one aspect of what's been going on there. Basically, nobody really wants to leave their own country because most people are quite happy where they are, where they know the customs and how, you know, you've got your friends, you know how to behave with other people, and you've got certain customs, you know how to fit in. So basically, I think that's basically what I've got to say. Okay.
To the UN, absolutely we should be. We should be leading in the UN to make sure that we are out there keeping the peace in the world and making sure that this world is safe and stable for our children and for the future. On the 0.7% on aid, again, absolutely we should be committing to that. I was lucky enough this week to meet the representatives of Save the Children, who told me about the 11 million children who've gone to school because of UK aid abroad. And that is the kind of work we should be doing, and more of it, to make sure that the world, again, is safe and stable because children have a future and aren't being left behind all over the world, because it's only going to benefit us in the UK if we're helping abroad. And on our obligations to refugees, I'm ashamed as a citizen of this country that's even a question about whether we meet our obligations to refugees. Absolutely we should meet our obligations, and I'm proud of the work that Alf Dubs has done on this. I'm proud of the work of Yvette Cooper, and I'm proud of the work of Stella Creasy from the Labour Party have done to ensure that refugees remain at the top of the agenda in our politics at the moment.
How many of those voted for volunteer?
Question number 7 from John, please. We might stand at the microphone.
If you are selected, can the people of your constituency, borough and country rely on your support on inquiries and investigations currently ongoing within the London Borough of Barnet Council and quite possibly others?
What's the question?
Can you repeat the question, please?
Sorry, I don't get the question either.
If you are elected, can the people of your constituency, borough and country, rely on your support on inquiries and investigations currently ongoing in the London Borough of Barnet Council and quite possibly others?
So, the election fraud or something, or what?
That's the question. Let the candidates answer, then we'll move on.
Thank you for your question. Clearly, if we don't know exactly the subject of the inquiry that you have in mind that you think should take place, but if there does emerge a request for an investigation of an important matter, certainly if I'm re-elected as an MP, I would look very seriously at whether a full inquiry was needed. But it's difficult to give you a very clear and firm answer without knowing a little more about the issue that you're concerned about.
Unfortunately, I don't know what inquiries or investigations you're referring to. However, what I would do as your MP is stand up to this council. This council that shut libraries without question. This council that voted for this. And no one stood up and said, what? I would stand up to this council and I would question their decisions. And if you are lucky enough to elect Labour-led council next year,
As much as they are my friends, I would question them as well if I felt what they were doing wasn't right for this constituency. You can speak truth to your friends and to the people who oppose you in politics, and that's what I would do.
Previously, yes, I will assist you. I have no details of any matters referred to, therefore I can't divulge anything which I shouldn't be divulging in this answer. But I have already met this gentleman and have said that I will assist him. Liberal Democrats believe in transparency, believe in probity, and believe that the local government and national government should be answerable to the people. I was 6 years a councillor myself in another authority area, and I know how to help you with this. And yes, I would do that. I'm a Liberal Democrat. I believe in the highest standards in local government. I took a local authority from the second highest category of performance to the absolute highest category of performance. And whichever party is running it, that's what I expect for the residents of Barnet, and I know how to get there already. Let me do it with you.
Before I answer this question, I need to go to the toilet. You know, David Cameron, he always doesn't go to the loo, just to give urgency, his sense of urgency in his voice, but I don't really want to have a part of it, so I'm going to...
Let's take a 2-minute break.
Okay, guys, I'll... Yeah, it's going to be a 2-minute break then. Okay, sorry about that. I'll be back shortly. But anyway, I'm not sure what the question was about. I'm not sure if it was about the Tory election fraud. But in any case, they did say that one reason that Theresa May has called for another election because of the 30 Tory MPs who actually may be guilty of, overspending in their elections. Anyway, peace out. I shall be back soon. Yes.